Hello everyone, welcome to the channel, welcome back. It's another time for us to come together for a Bible study where we can study God's word together. I'm excited. I'm always excited at every opportunity I have to study God's word and to share from God's word with his people. So let's just say a quick prayer before we get into the teaching today. For today, Father, we ask that the eyes of our understanding be enlightened. Open our eyes that we may see, open our ears, our hearts that we may understand. Speak to us and give us the grace to practice and to change our ways based on what we learned today. Thank you, Father, for in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So as the title suggests, today we're going to be discussing sex. So, pop quiz before we start. Quick pop quiz. Is sex a physical activity or is sex a spiritual activity? So, if you think sex is a physical activity, please raise your hand. Okay. If you think sex is a spiritual activity, also raise your hand, please. Okay. So, if you answered and said sex is a physical activity, then you are correct. If you answered and you said sex is a spiritual activity, you are correct. Both of you are correct. So sex is both physical and spiritual. So first we need to understand that an activity can be physical and also be spiritual. Is not only one way or the other. It can be both physical and spiritual. And there are some things or some phenomenon that we examine or that we see almost on a daily basis on the earth that we think are just physical things, but they are actually spiritual. God is actually behind them. So for instance, rain. When we read scriptures like Job, chapter 37, verse 6, it says, "For he says to the snow," or "he saith to the snow, be thou on the earth, likewise to the small rain and to the great rain of his strength." So the Bible says, God says to snow, come down to the earth. And because God said to the snow comes to the earth. He also gives this command to rain, to both small rain, you know, in other words, small showers, and to great rain, so like heavy rains, heavy downpours. So the Bible says God sends rain upon the earth. But there's a scientific way you can understand rainfall. So things like condensation, evaporation, the clouds getting full and them emptying themselves on the earth, which I'm not saying is a lie, which is also true. But because there's a physical explanation or something physical we can observe does not mean rainfall or a lack thereof. It's just a plainly physical thing. Another example of something that is physical or looks physical but is actually spiritual is giving birth to children. So there's a scientific explanation for how children come about. A man, a woman, an egg, an ovary, sperm, fertilization, 9 months, etc., etc. So there are ways we can understand childbirth from a physical / scientific perspective. But we know that God gives children. The Bible says children are heritage from the Lord. So God gives people children. And that's why when people can't have children, they cry out to God because they know it's a problem only God can solve. So there are things that look physical or that have physical components, right? But are also spiritual. And many times the spiritual dimension is far more impactful than the physical. So one of those things is sex, where the spiritual ramifications of doing it the wrong way can destroy a person, can literally ruin their life. But because people are not cognizant and not constantly aware, so people don't even know that sex is spiritual. They think it's just two human beings and flesh. So in case you don't know, now you know, and you will know more by the end of this video. So because people are not aware or they don't have it at the back of their minds that sex is a spiritual activity, they just engage in it willy-nilly and end up destroying themselves. But an understanding of the spiritual side of sex will help us to approach it the way God wants to approach it, to see it as something that should only be had in marriage, to understand it and look at it with the gravity with which God sees it, and not just to have it anyhow because it's available. So, imagine a man who wants to get married. So this man has a spirit. So man is spirit, soul, and body. So the man has a spirit. For the sake of this illustration, I'm going to say the man is a spirit. So the man is a spirit. He is one spirit. He is only one spirit. So he decides to get married. He goes, he finds a lady that he loves. They get married and they move in together. So now, there are two spirits inside the house, or there are two spirits inside the house. The man has his own spirit, or is a spirit. The woman is also a spirit. So these are spirits. These are not things you can't touch your spirit. You can't see it. You can't create a spirit because it's something that is spiritual. You can't even see it, but you know you have a spirit. So in the house at this point in time, there are only two spirits, the man and his wife. So after some time, they now decide, okay, we want to become intimate. So they start having intimacy with each other. And after a period of time, the woman is pregnant. So now there are three spirits in the house. The man is a spirit. The woman is a spirit. The baby is also a spirit. So the baby is not just flesh and bones. It's not just a cute, cuddly, chubby human being. The baby has a spirit. So there were only two spirits in the house before. But after sexual intimacy, now there are three spirits. So how can an activity that is purely physical bring about a spirit? How can an activity, if you believe that sex is just flesh, how can an activity that is only physical result in the introduction of a third spirit? A spirit that was not on earth before, because that baby was not on earth, therefore his spirit was not on earth. Presumably he was in heaven. So how can two people do something that is just physical, and after they finish, the number of spirits on the earth increased by one? So let me ask you a question. If I decide to polish my shoe, right, just take my shoes, dusty, and I want to polish it, can polishing my shoe bring about any sort of spiritual outcome? Can polishing my shoe affect the realm of the spirit in any way, shape, or form? No, it can't. Because polishing my shoe is purely a physical activity. It has absolutely nothing to do with the realm of the spirit. So me polishing my shoe cannot affect the realm of the spirit. Another example, if I decide to wash my car, can washing my car result in the introduction of another spirit? Can it even have any sort of effect on the realm of the spirit because my car is dirty and I just said, let me go and wash it? Of course it can't, because it's purely a physical activity. So only spiritual activities can even impact the realm of the spirit. Only physical spiritual activities can touch the realm of the spirit. And better still, only spiritual activities can introduce a new spirit that was not on earth into the earth. So sex is a highly spiritual activity. And what it does is, when two people decide to be intimate, it opens them up to the realm of the spirit. When they decide to be intimate, at that time, they think they are just being physical, but they're not just being physical. At that time, there's an opening. Both of them have been opened up to the realm of the spirit. And it is that opening that allows God to drop a new spirit into the womb of the woman, because at that point there's an opening, they have been opened up. So it's at that point that a new spirit can be deposited into the womb of the woman. It is that open. But that at that time when they are engaging in intimacy and they are open to the realm of the spirit, keep in mind that there are many spirits on earth and many of them are demons. Many of the spirits on earth are demons. So when somebody engages in any form of spiritual activity at all, anytime anybody decides to engage the realm of the spirit at all, that person has to be covered by God so that other spirits do not interrupt that process. So any form of spiritual activity at all through which somebody opens himself up to the realm of the spirit, if he's not covered by God, then other spirits will join him there. For instance, if I see a bunch of witches, not myself, let me use someone else. If somebody sees a bunch of witches holding a festival, and they are dancing and playing and offering sacrifices, and the person thinks it's a joke, he doesn't know that these are real witches. He thinks maybe they are just in a costume and are just having fun. Then he goes there and joins the sacrifice. What he did is he has opened himself up to the realm of the spirit. He has created an opening into the realm of the spirit. But because that opening is not covered by God, demons will possess him. Anytime anybody does any form of spiritual activity that is not protected by God, he will encounter demons. So for instance, I'm using another example. If somebody sees members of a cult and they are doing their initiation, they are drinking blood, and he also thinks it's a joke, that maybe the blood is just some wine and they are just fooling around, he goes and joins them and becomes initiated, even if he thinks it's a joke. Through that initiation, he opens himself up to the realm of the spirit. But because that process was not covered by God, a spirit will possess him. So going back to sex, anytime people engage in this activity outside of marriage, because it's only in the sanctity of marriage that God covers sex, because that's where it is ordained by God. In this process, when they are married, God covers them, so they are clothed, they are shielded from all the demons that are flying around in the earth. But when they decide to have it outside marriage, either through adultery or fornication, when they open themselves up to the realm of the spirit, they can get a spirit. It won't happen every time. Because, for instance, if you stay in an area where there are rats, and you leave your door open, it's not every day you leave your door open, a rat will enter. You can leave your door open for 5 days, 6 days, and no rat will enter your house. But if you keep leaving your door open, a day will come that a rat will enter your house. It's 100% true. So when people engage in fornication, they may not catch a spirit the first day, the second day, the third, but eventually they will get a spirit. So let's go through one very interesting passage in 1 Corinthians chapter 7. So keep in mind that 1 Corinthians chapter 7 is one of the chapters where sex is discussed in the Bible. So Apostle Paul talks about how the man should not withhold himself or his body from his wife, and the woman should not withhold herself from her husband sexually, because they have a duty to fulfill to each other. He also goes to talk about how the man does not have power over his own body because his body belongs to his wife. And the wife does not have power over her own body because her body belongs to her husband. So there's a lot of, maybe not a lot, but there are discussions around sex, because this is addressed to married people. So in this, when you're reading this chapter, you have to understand that in the background or at the beginning of it, because we are going to jump to verse 14, there are discussions around sex and the implications of sex in marriage. So in 1 Corinthians 7 from verse 14, Apostle Paul says, "For the unbelieving husband is sanctified by the wife, and the unbelieving wife is sanctified by the husband. Else were your children unclean, but now are they holy." He says, the unbelieving husband is sanctified by the wife, and the unbelieving wife is sanctified by the husband. Else were your children unclean, but now are they holy. So, the background to this is Apostle Paul traveled to Corinth and began to preach to the Corinthians. So, some people were already married, right? So, when he preached to a couple, Sometimes the man will give his life to Christ and the woman will not, or the woman will give her life to Christ and the man will not. So there will be one spouse who is a born-again believer, and there's another spouse who does not believe in Jesus Christ. So at this point, he's now telling them not to divorce, that if the unbelieving spouse does not want to divorce, the person who is not a believer does not want a divorce and is willing to stay with you in the marriage, he says you can stay with the person. Because he goes on to say that your salvation can, your godly conduct can also lead the person to Christ. So he says if the person does not want to go, you can stay with the person. But in verse 14, he now begins to talk about sexual intercourse and the children. He now says that when they sleep together, he's saying that the one who is not a believer sanctifies the one who is a believer. Sorry, the one who is a believer sanctifies the one who is not a believer. If not, their children will be unclean, but now are they holy. So let me just put an asterisk here now. This is not talking of people who deliberately go and marry unbelievers. So somebody now will be thinking, David Abraham said, I can go and marry an unbeliever, and when I sleep with him, I will sanctify. That one is your business, and you will catch a demon. He is talking to people who were already married. And now, so these Corinthians were idol worshippers, by the way. I don't want to, we'll get to this eventually. But the point is, this is referring to people who were already married. So this is not an excuse for an unbeliever, for a believer to go and marry someone who is not an unbeliever. So let's break down the terms in this verse. It says, for the unbelieving husband is sanctified by the wife, and the unbelieving wife is sanctified by the husband. Else were your children unclean, but now are they holy. So there's a lot of controversy or confusion about what does this term unclean, because it's saying your children are unclean. But if the believing one does not sanctify the unbelieving one, your children will be unclean. So we need to understand, what does this unclean mean? So unclean in the New Testament always relates to two things. Number one, it relates to sin. When we talk about uncleanness, it means people who, generally speaking, have thrown themselves into sin and defiled themselves by iniquity. So uncleanness is used in Ephesians 5, I think verse 15, to describe those kind of people who dwell in their iniquity. So he says those people are full of uncleanness. They walk uncleanness. So he's referring to sin. So he says, else were your children unclean. He says, if the believing spouse does not sanctify the unbeliever when they sleep together, the children that come out will be unclean. But we know that this is not talking of sin, because every child comes out with sin. There's no child who comes out already a born-again believer and is the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. Every child that comes out, whether they come out from a Christian couple or they come out from a couple that don't even know God, every child comes out with sin. There's no child that comes out already the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. Every child has to believe God for himself when he gets to the age of accountability, where he can understand the gospel and understand who Jesus is. Every child has to receive Christ for himself, and every child has to believe and have faith and then become the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. And it is then that he is now clean and righteous. So unclean in this sense does not refer to sin, because it doesn't matter whether the parents are born again or they are not born again. So it doesn't refer to sin. The second instance, or the second way the word unclean is used in the New Testament, is referring to demonic activity, is referring to demons. They are called unclean spirits in the New Testament. So where this word unclean is used in the New Testament, in fact, a large majority of the time, maybe up to, I've not done the calculation, but probably over 90% of the time, if not 99% of the time, where the word unclean is used in the New Testament is referring to the activity of demons spirits. So, a quick backstory to understand what was happening in the Corinthian church. So, these Corinthians were not just unbelievers who are just like atheists or just like, I don't know, practicing secular humanism. They are not just on their own and just ignoring God. They're actually idol worshippers, or they were idol worshippers. If you know anything about Corinth, it was full of idols, different gods and different prostitutes and sacrifices, and all sorts of demonic stuff was going on. So they weren't just like Americans or Europeans who just are just atheists and are just living their life without prayer. They actually worship devils. So they offered sacrifices to these demons. The Bible says the things which the Gentiles sacrifice to, they sacrifice to devils. So keep in mind that these people know they are worshiping demons. It's not just like we're just offering strange sacrifices. They commune with these demons. The Bible says they peep and they mutter. They commune with familiar spirits. So it's like somebody who is a native doctor. He's not like ignorant of what he's doing. He knows that he's a native doctor. He knows that he's talking to demons. It's like somebody who is a witch and flies in the night and is possessed with devils. They know. So it's not something they are doing ignorantly. So these Corinthians were worshipping idols, which the Bible lets us know are demons. Follow the progression. Before Paul came to preach to them, there's a man who is an idol worshipper. He's worshipping the devil, his spirit. He knows. He talks to the demons. They pray to the demons. They offer sacrifices. Some even kill their children. So they know. He marries a woman who is also an idol worshipper. They also commune with these demons. They worship the demons. They love the demons, etc., etc. So in the process of time of worshiping these demons, they become possessed by the demons. Just like when we worship God and we give our lives to Christ, the Holy Spirit lives in us. So the spirits inhabit them. So when we talk about demonic possession, people only imagine it in the sense of people running around crazy on the street. But if you study the Bible, it's not every time somebody was possessed by a demon that they ran around crazy. Many of them were possessed by demons and they lived normal lives. The reason it looked like they were always crazy is when they came near Jesus, the demons now began to rebel. The demons began to manifest themselves because of the power that emanated from Jesus and because they knew they were going to be cast out. So it looked like everybody who came to Jesus was either rolling on the floor, convulsing, screaming, and just stark raving mad. But they were not all like that. So when normal people who went to school, had jobs, married, and were living with their demons normally, it's not every witch who flies in the night who has a demon that is stark raving mad. Some of your colleagues are witches. Some of your classmates are witches. They are not crazy. They have their senses and they know what they are doing. So when I say that these Corinthians were demon-possessed, worshipping demons, I'm not saying they were running around crazy. They had demons living in them. And they knew because they fellowshiped with these demons. So now Apostle Paul comes to preach to one of them. That one gives his life to Christ, right? He's married. Both of them are worshiping demons. Both of them had demons in them. So he gives his life to Christ, but his wife does not give her life to Christ. So he gives his life to Christ. He renounces his demons. The demons are cast out, and he's now holy and pure. So he's holy, he's pure. His wife is still worshiping spirits. She's not crazy, she's not mad, but she doesn't want to leave the marriage. But she has spirits in her. The guy is now afraid to sleep with his wife because he knows that these demons can pass through sexual intercourse from his wife to him. So Apostle Paul is saying that the unbelieving husband is sanctified by the wife, and the unbelieving wife is sanctified by the husband. He now says, if not, your children will be unclean. If not, even the children, the demons will pass from the spouse who refused to give their life to Christ and catch the children. Even the children will come out with demons. So what Apostle Paul is saying is that the spirit can pass through sex, pass from the wife, pass to the husband, and even enter into the children through sex. So let's study this word unclean, because so we're very clear what it means. So the word unclean in the Greek is the word akathos. I hope I'm pronouncing it correctly. Akathos. And let's see the full meaning of it. So you can see it now. It says unclean, impure, in reference to demons. So you can see that I first highlighted it from the passage. I didn't just pick it. You can see that it's highlighted unclean from the 1 Corinthians 7:14 that we're reading. And from there, you can first see what the word means, akathos. Now, this is the definition. It says unclean, impure, in reference to demons. So what he's saying is that the children can come out with demons if one of the spouses has a demon. But let's go ahead and see the different places in which this same word was used in the New Testament. So you can see all the references. And every time it is used, it's talking about what? Unclean spirits. Unclean spirits. So, the unbelieving spouse who has a demon, if not that they are married, they are legally married under the eyes of God, though. I'm not just talking of in society. They are married in the eyes of God. They got married before one person gave his life to Christ. So it's not like one person went to go and marry an unbeliever. So because they are married legally in the eyes of God, when they have sex, the spirit cannot pass from one person to the other person. God sanctifies them. Sanctifies the one who is a believer and also sanctifies the children. So the spirit cannot be transferred. The implication of this is, if you are not married, you know, you just go out, you just see somebody, you just say, wow, this lady looks good. You just met her, I don't know, at a restaurant, in your friend's place, and you just do, let's just hook up, one night stand. You will hook yourself up with a spirit, with a devil, with a demon spirit. That's what the Bible is teaching. You will hook yourself up with a demon spirit. A guy just comes, you as your sister, you just see the guy is just looking handsome, you know, just has six packs and everything, and just say, wow, this nice brother, the guy just comes, toast you. I tell you to behave yourself, you know, these Christians, and behave yourself with holiness and righteousness. They say, we're under grace. Let's just behave like fools. You will meet a demon. You will be very surprised. You will be very shocked that through sexual intimacy, you will meet a demon. So the first danger of having sex outside marriage is that you can sleep with somebody who has a spirit and you will get the same spirit. Because spirits don't show on faces. Everybody's smiling. Everybody looks handsome. Everybody does makeup. Everybody barbs his hair. And like we've seen from scriptures, it's not everybody that has a spirit that is running around crazy on the street. Some of them are walking with you in your offices. They are even in church, singing in church with demons inside them. So you meet somebody, you're not married, you just decide that, you know what, I just like the person. And since we're under grace, let's make a fool of God's mercy and just be fornicating and telling God we are sorry. When the person has a demon and you sleep with him, that demon will lay on, he will lay his hands, he will enter you too and possess you. The second danger of having sex outside marriage is that even if the person does not have a spirit, because two of you have opened yourself up to the realm of the spirit through ungodliness, breaking the law of God in relation to intimacy in marriage, that opening into the realm of the spirit can allow any spirit that is passing. Demon spirits that should not have any business with you. On a normal day, they will now come and lay hold upon you because there is an opening, a gap to the realm of the spirit has been created. And when these things happen, when these demons begin to lay hold on people who are Christians, they really can't go as far as making them crazy, making them mad, making you like tear your clothes and run around on the street, because you have the Holy Spirit, so there's a seal of God on you. So what the demon can do with you is not the same as what the demon can do with the madman in Gadara who did not have the Holy Spirit in him. So the demon will not be able to make you run around and just be crazy. But he will now begin to manipulate and orchestrate circumstances in your life that on a normal day should not have taken place. Because an opening has been created and you've allowed that demon access to your temple by defiling it, by defiling the temple of God. So, you know that what makes a man holy is the presence of a Holy Spirit in him. You know, The reason any of us is holy is because when you give your life to Christ, He gave you a Holy Spirit, a spirit of holiness, the Holy Spirit. So when the Holy Spirit enters you, He purifies you. He makes you holy. Anybody who does not have the Holy Spirit can never be holy. Anybody who gives his life to Christ must receive the Holy Spirit. It is the entrance of the Holy Spirit into a man that makes him holy. In the same vein, it is the entrance of an unclean spirit into a man that makes him unclean. That's why these children will come out unclean. And that's why if the unbelieving spouse or if the believing spouse does not sanctify the unbelieving spouse, the believing spouse will become unclean. In other words, if there is no covering by God because they are married, the other one will become unclean because an unclean spirit will dwell inside that person's temple. Because the spirit is a spirit of uncleanness, anywhere it touches it will make it unclean. It's a defiler. It's like if my hand is dirty, if I stain my hand with engine oil or charcoal, if I touch my leg will become dirty. If I touch your leg will become dirty. If I touch my car key, it will become dirty. If I touch my remote, anything I touch, it becomes dirty. So these unclean spirits, they defile. They are defilers. They defile. And it's either they defile the place by their presence, or they look for a place that is already defiled. Because the place is already defiled, it becomes convenient for them. Is it that they defile it by themselves when they get there, or they look for a place that is already defiled, and the presence of that defilement is what makes it what? Convenient for them. So when you defile your temple, you know, the Bible talks about when people engage in sex outside of marriage, it is a defilement of the temple of God. When you defile that temple has now become a powerful hotspot for devils, for demons. Because that defilement, they love defilement, is what attracts them. Let me tell you a story. So there's this woman. She's 25. Gave her life to Christ right from when she was young. Serving the Lord faithfully, and was a virgin. She had a spiritual husband in her family. That spiritual husband used to molest every woman in the family. So the spiritual husband molested her great-grandmother, molested her grandmother, even molested her mother. But she didn't know. Nobody in the family told her. She had no idea. So, her great-grandmother was dead, her grandmother was dead, even her mother was dead. So, there was no way, nobody told her before they died, and now they were gone. So, she didn't know that this spirit that had molested all the women in her family before her was now looking for a way to molest her too. But because she was saved, born again, it was difficult for the spirit to harass this lady. So, when she's sleeping at night, the spiritual husband will come. And when he comes, he notices that her temple is pure. He's trying to look for a loophole to enter the temple and defile her and molest her, even in her dreams. But every time he comes, the temple is pure. And he goes back. He will come again and check. The temple is pure. He goes back. He comes again and checks. This was going on for years. Keep in mind that this lady is 25. So this spirit has been trying since she was about 17. And this lady was not aware. She was just living her life, praying, fasting, serving God, and everything. She didn't even know that this spirit was always coming to try and molest her in her sleep, but she never knew. So one day, she was under pressure of everybody has a boyfriend. I don't have a boyfriend. So one ungodly, godless guy now showed up from nowhere. And she likes the guy. And talking, one thing led to another, they now fornicated. When they fornicated, it created a defilement. It defiled her temple. So that night she slept, after they finished fornicating, repented, because of course she's under grace, and went to sleep. That night, the spiritual husband came. God. He came! But unfortunately for her, He came and met her defiled. That defilement was the opening that this spirit was molesting this lady in her sleep for 5 years. This lady was so shocked that all of a sudden, a spiritual husband, a man she never knew, never saw, where did he come from, molesting her night after night in her sleep? What she didn't know is that fornication is what opened the door. This lady was so shocked, crying to God every day. She's like, how can something come? I'm praying. I am fasting. I have the Holy Spirit in me. Something is molesting me in my sleep with the Holy Spirit inside of me. How is it possible? She has angels. This is what she was saying. I have angels that are watching over me every night while I sleep. They are supposed to be watching. They are watching and something is molesting me in my sleep. How is it possible? With all the prayer and fasting and angels, that something has that level of access to a temple. The temple that the Holy Spirit is inside. No. A door was created.